saints we see are all made of gold. When your dreams all fail and the wounds we hail are the worst of all and the bloods run stale, I wanna hide the truth, I wanna shelter you, but with the beast inside there's nowhere we can hide. No matter what we breed, we still are made of greed. This is my kingdom come, this is my kingdom come.
My name is Bobby Milroy. I was a professional badminton player for 12 years. I'm from Canada, but I lived in Denmark. And during that time, I actually became the highest-ranked Canadian men's singles player of all time at 18
in the world. My name is Anna Rice, and I am from Canada. And probably my greatest accomplishment is representing Canada in the 2004 and 2008 Olympics in the sport of badminton.
I'm Shannon Vole. And my greatest accomplishment in badminton, I guess, would be making it to 4 world championships, and one of the times making it to top 32 at the world championships, top 32 in the world, and getting to the number one ranking in the United States.
I was 6, and we joined sports because my family was going through a divorce when I was that age, and so they put all of the kids in a whole bunch of sports, and badminton was one of the ones we had an international coach in the area.
I was 8 years old, and I'm the youngest of 3 girls, so my older sisters played, so of course I was just dying to try it every time after watching them play. So I don't remember actually the very first time I played, but I just remember playing at that young age and just loving to play and just knowing like this is something that I really
I was a high school freshman trying out for the badminton team, so I never played before I was 14.
I would say about 10 years old. I had to choose. I was quite a good swimmer, and I was a good badminton player, and I had to choose. And so I was thinking a lot about it one summer, and I knew that if I wanted to have a chance to be world class or Olympic class at one of them, I had to sacrifice. So then over that summer, one day I just realized that I wanted to play badminton, and that and from that point on, I was in my heart committed.
Well, I loved all sports. I was one of those really like energetic kids that my parents put me in sports so that I could vent energy. And so I loved all sorts of sports. I did dancing as well. But as I became like a teenager, I realized like badminton was just something that really kept me focused and kept me kind of on a good path, like kept me focused on being healthy. And you know, it's a hard time and it's easy to get kind of distracted and think that, you know, partying and doing other things is more important. But so yeah, that's when I knew, okay, this is something that I want to really put my energy in. And for me, a passion is something that when you do it, it's like time stands still. And that's definitely for me on the badminton court. Like an hour can go by and it's like 5 minutes.
You know, I really loved it in high school, but I played many sports. I played tennis, I was a figure skater, I was a cheerleader. And then slowly I stopped doing some of the other sports and focused in just till it was tennis and badminton. And when I went off to college, I was considering playing tennis at a smaller school for like a Division III team or playing badminton. And what really made me decide that I was really passionate about badminton was every time I went to tournaments, I would meet players from around the world. And not only was I playing badminton, but I was making friends with players from all different countries, because the tournaments in the United States really draw an international crowd, because badminton is the second most popular sport in the world and a lot of Americans don't play. So when you go to a tournament, I would meet players from China and Indonesia and Japan and Germany and Denmark and all these countries, and that cultural exchange kind of made me originally fall in love with badminton. And then as I became more and more successful and realized that not only do I love this sport, but I'm pretty good at it, and I can play for the national team, and then eventually, who knew I would make a career out of it as a coach.
have to, I mean, basically, the one who plays most often is probably going to win. So I had to play more than anybody else I knew, and so it was basically a total life commitment. I arranged my school around my badminton, my social life around my badminton. My wife is a badminton player, so everything I did was around badminton, and that is something, if you have a dream, I think you have to put everything around your life into it.
There's a lot of sacrifice. Anything worthwhile comes with sacrifice, and I love the saying that if it was easy, everybody would do it. So, right? Like, if it was easy to get to the Olympics, everyone would be at the Olympics. So there's always sacrifice involved. Probably the sacrifice when you're younger is like I mentioned, giving up parties or giving up, you know, going home to study to get that done so that you can make sure you have time to practice and go to training and stuff and really organizing your time. So you sacrifice a little bit on the social side. But for me, that's a big gain because you make friends in sports and you make friends in badminton. I have friends all around the world too. So it's a sacrifice at the time, but it's also a huge payoff as well. But probably as I got older, then a sacrifice is like I moved away from home. So I sacrificed kind of getting to see my family a lot and stuff. So that was a sacrifice, but they supported me. And so...
A lot. I was invited to the Olympic Training Center to train in college, but I didn't want to drop out of my university before I finished. So I had to sacrifice a year of training with the national team so I could finish my college degree. Once I did that, I had to train with the best players in the country, so I had to move to California to do that. I soon found that that wasn't going to give me a high enough quality of training to try to make the Olympic team.
So I realized I wasn't going to be able to make it at the top level of being in the Olympics. So I quit my job, I sold my car, I fundraised for a year, I did raffles, I went door to door with letters asking funding. I found support from the entire community, and friends, family, friends, community organizations to help fundraise to help make it to Denmark, Architrans, the International Badminton Academy. I moved to a foreign country. I lived there for 3.5 years, 100% devoted to learning to play badminton. And even though I had a college degree, I took a job with an au pair where I walked floors and I cleaned people's houses. And I took care of children, and did anything I could to help pay for my expenses. I waited tables, anything I could to pay for my expenses through training and
work. I think the hardest struggle was realizing at a certain point that I had to become not only a better player, but a better person in order to do as well as I could and be the best badminton player I could. And so being able to look at yourself and know and admit that you have certain weaknesses, everyone has them. So I have my own, or I had my own and have my own particular ones. And I believe that is the hardest thing to do, is to admit your weakness, because your weakness always hides at the place you don't want to look at. So it's a lifelong journey for me to realize it. But that was a very difficult but rewarding process.
The day I got to the Olympics in Beijing, I found out that my grandma had died. I knew she was sick and she was, you know, it was probably going to happen soon, but it was still really hard, and I had to focus on my game because I knew that's what she would have wanted me to do, is just play my best. And so that was probably one of the biggest challenges, because it's really hard to stay focused, and you know, you're feeling sad and badly that I wasn't there with her, but I was doing what I knew she would have wanted me to do. So
the hardest struggle was financially paying for it. I think the Olympic quest for me was an endeavor that cost about $130,000. When you consider that I've had to train full time expenses, my stable managing expenses, my travel expenses, my coaching expenses, my tournament expenses, and trying to find the funding to do that. And then once I found the funding to do that, trying to not be nervous, knowing that I have $100,000 riding on every point, and trying to relax and stay calm and realize it's just support. I'm doing it for fun.
My dad was one of my great motivations. He's a businessman, not an athlete, but I took a lot of motivation, number one, by his example, because he used to work so hard. He dedicated his life to his business, so that's where I got that role modeling. and then I wanted to live up to that example. And so I always push very hard because of that. And then I drew a lot of motivations from a lot of other great sport heroes. Chicago Bulls, Michael Jordan was definitely.
My greatest motivation has probably been my sisters and my mom, because like I mentioned, my older sisters played badminton, and so that inspired me to want to play. And my mom, just because she works really hard and she taught us to work really hard but also stay true to ourselves, because that's more important than any Olympic medal.
Oh, that was great. I traveled in my career to 80 different countries. And so the world becomes a bigger place all of a sudden. You realize that your own small experience of it is only a small part of the big picture. So it really it changes your perspectives. You really do appreciate the freedoms and opportunities that you have when you see people in other countries who, I mean, just the majority of people don't live like we live in the Western world. I'm from Canada, and you know, you're living in the U.S., but you know, most people in the world just do not have the same opportunities. It's such a small percent, and so it's almost criminal not to go after your dream, because so many people in the world, they don't have
great.
An option.
I have friends. That's what brought me here to Chicago, because I have made friends with Shannon at tournaments, and I've got to travel to over 50 countries around the world to play badminton, so I have friends in all those countries and keep in touch now with email and everything.
Big Bang was nice. I mean, if you know, if you didn't have that, then well, I'm a big fan of the Industrial Revolution in general. So that was a big thing for me. I also, you know, V-Day in World War II is a big deal for me. Actually, my grandfather was a prisoner of war in Nazi Germany. So then, you know, that day or day after my grandfather and grandmother met, and so without that particular day and that particular intervention, then you know, I wouldn't be here. And you know, on top of that, it's a significant day because maybe our countries wouldn't be here. So that's a very important.
I really like looking at like celebrations in history and how different cultures celebrate in different ways. You know, every culture likes to have a good party, and, you know, whether it's a wedding or some kind of big event, then it's just fun to see, despite all our differences over time, then people still like to get together and have a good time.
My strengths, I've been able to dedicate myself 100% to that. That wasn't as much of a sacrifice for me as maybe it is for some people who just, they just enjoy life too much and do things to give up partying and to spend that much time doing one thing. So I always had that passion. I was open for that, and then I think I'm quite open-minded. So I was able to make adaptations within myself. That's a very hard thing to do. Most people, you know them when they're 10 years old and when they're 30, and they're basically the same person, only more facial hair matters. But if you're able to make improvements, it really is a quality that I'm thankful I'm able to do, because I should be able to keep improving the rest of my life.
I think definitely my work ethic, like, I'm willing to practice and to train and to keep doing something. You know, there's said that you have to do something for 10,000 hours before you can be considered an expert at it. And I really like to just keep working at something until I can do it. And I don't give up until I can. Even if I have doubts, I just keep trying. And then it usually you'll figure it out. And the more I tell my students, yeah, in Vancouver, where I'm from, it's like every badminton practice is like an orange, but it could be every day at school is like an orange, or every class is like an orange. And how much juice you get out of that orange is up to how much effort you put in and how much you squeeze. Every student or every player has the same orange, but one student might squeeze and really focus and listen and concentrate and get a full glass of orange juice. Mm. And then someone else might not put in their best effort, and they only get a few drops. And even though they've both been there for the same amount of time, one is getting way more out of it. So you always want to try and think of how you can get the most juice out of every single thing that you're doing, because that's how you're going to be less thirsty.